Coming on next is Saul Kaplan. Saul Kaplan's probably, you know, the king of innovation in Rhode Island. And Saul, you out there?
Yes, I'm here.
Come on in.
I'm here. How are
Great
you?
To see you.
Hey, Josh.
Come on
How
up.
Are you?
Get that foot right on there.
Okay.
And so Gary's covered all the financial issues. You're off the hook.
You know
there.
What it's like to follow Gary Sass. You know, we work together, Gary and I, in state government here, and we had some really incredible interactions around tax policy. But we do. Gary's the best. It's nice to see Gary.
No, it's great. We were having breakfast one day, and I was telling him about this initiative to kind of go live every day, and he said, I could bring the money man back. And I'm like, cha-ching, yes, absolutely.
Let's do it.
So we're really excited about it. You've done one of the more, I mean, this is not a state rich in innovation per se in many ways. And you've kind of created a two-headed monster of innovation doing kind of two different things under the same roof. Talk a little bit about Biff and Biff.
Yeah. Well, first of all, let me just take a second to congratulate you and the Go Local Live team, because if we're going to talk about innovation, you know, we can talk about innovation in media and what you're trying to do and the lively experiment that you guys do here. So thanks for having me.
We haven't broken it yet.
Not yet.
Yeah. No. Not at all.
I always tell every new person that comes to work with us at Biff, it's the same. I always tell them, you can't break it.
No.
Like, don't worry. Explore. Test. Try. Which is a lot of what innovators do. Let's talk about Rhode Island. First of all, like when you say you don't think of Rhode Island as a place to innovate, wait, let's dial that back a little bit.
Yep.
Go back to the industrial era, right? Actually founded here, as you
Absolutely.
Know.
Absolutely.
Right? So this is where innovation started.
Well, and I'd also say we probably couldn't have done Go Local maybe in any other market. Just because of the talent level we were able to tap into and have been able to consistently tap into.
Well, not only do we have incredible talent here in the state, very diverse talent, you know, across lots of different industries and lots of different disciplines, but we're the smallest state in the country, so you almost get this delusion that if we could just have a little bit more collaboration muscle, if we could just connect the dots where we were all concerned about making the whole bigger, making the pie bigger, instead of what our little slice of that pie is, then you could actually turn this into an innovation lab and an innovation platform. And that's how we should be positioning Rhode Island nationally and globally.
Right.
We should take our size and make it an advantage. Biff was started based on that very simple idea. Why can't this be a real-world platform for innovation? What's next?
Yeah.
What's next, whether we're talking about healthcare, education, you know, pick any industry you want. So I saw that potential. I wanted that conversation to be central to the way we thought about our economic future. And we founded Biff as one of a number of things.
So describe for folks who don't know it, there's a consulting, is it fair to say, a consulting arm?
Yep.
And then there's the summit.
Yep, so we run a summit every year. This will be our 13th year doing it. It's a celebration of what I call the innovation junkies, and they come from all over the world.
And you've had rock stars. I mean, just name some of the rock stars.
Oh, we've had incredible innovators. We had Mark Cuban, Dan Pinkspin multiple times.
Right. You know, Zappos, we've had, CEO a couple times.
Tony Hsieh is a good friend and has been here. The common theme is, let's have people share genuine stories of what they do to transform themselves, their company, their industries, and let's try to figure out how we could make transformation easier and simple and safer to manage. Because everyone gets really scared when they hear the word. They hear disruption and they hear transformation, and they think that we have to stop doing everything we're doing now and we have to completely reinvent it and change everything.
Right.
Well, the way to do that never happens as a big bang approach. It always happens with, can we model it? Can we start smaller? Can we figure out how to scale? And these are the advantages Rhode Island has because of its scale, because we all know each other.
Right.
And so we've been collecting innovation junkies and connecting them together in purposeful ways now for 13 years.
And you're being shy because, was it Inc.?
Me?
Yeah.
Me shy?
Inc. magazine named it the second best sort of business get together in the free world.
We were really proud. Yeah, this just came out.
I mean, I don't know what's going on in North Korea. Yeah. They might have better, more innovative things going on, but in the free world, you were number two.
We got ranked the second most innovative conference, and it happens right here in Providence. It's an incredible calling card to position Rhode Island as an innovation hub, and it attracts people from all over, you know, to come together to figure out
how
we
can
make
them. Can we just keep them?
Well,
when they all come,
we've had a lot of people that have come here. We've had a lot of collaborations that happen because of it, and hopefully, we've gotten a lot of folks here in Rhode Island to understand what does it really mean to innovate.
Right.
What does it really mean not just to think about innovation as the next new invention or technology,
right,
but innovation as a better way to solve the actual problems that we have, the things that we as students or patients or citizens know and are very frustrated today that institutions aren't positioned to be able to solve our challenges and to help us. So our work at BIF is to try to help leaders figure out how they can do the exploration of that. How do we explore something that isn't a tweak or an incremental change, but a transformational change, a whole new model? And Lord knows we need transformational change today.
Earlier in the Lifestyle Hour, we had Fred from Luke and Danny, who has taken an old line jewelry company and transformed it and gave up a Wall Street gig to do it.
Right.
And then another finance guy started a whiskey company in Rhode
Island. That's so cool.
And, you know, both of them, I was chiding Molly, how did she get them? They should have been in the Business Hour because they could have been in either place, and they're just really driving innovation in both their businesses.
That's really important what you just said. Like, we tend to segment these things. So when we think innovation, we think Silicon Valley and high tech and new technology, right? Which are cool, and I'm glad that we do those things. But innovation is about solving the problem. We have more technology available to us today than we humans know how to use. The part of innovation we have to work on is not the invention of the next technology. It's the reinvention of us as humans to actually work together in a different way, to work in a more focused way, you know, to solve the problems that we're facing and learn how to model entire new approaches, not just the ones that are tweaks.
Right.
That's the work that we do.
So the summit takes place every September and usually around the second week or so.
Yep.
And then all the videos and presentations are all available, which I don't think people
12
realize.
years of videos of we call them storytellers, not speakers, because we get them to share genuine stories of how they've transformed themselves, their organizations, or their communities. We have 12 years of videos, 30 plus per year, all sitting for free available on our site, businessinnovationfactory.com.
Yeah.
And then the summit itself, which is a convening that brings about 500 people here. We work over at Trinity Rep. They've Kurt and the team there.
It's the perfect venue.
And it's the most inspiring days of the year. And everybody creates new connections and collaboration. And I hear every day, someone will say to me, you know, Saul, I was at the 7th BIF, 6 years ago.
Don't you remember
me? Let me tell you a story of who I collided with and who I've collaborated with and how it's changed the way I work and what I do. Most rewarding thing that happens to me today is being reminded of the work that we've been doing all these years to help people. We call it random collisions of unusual suspects. Stop hanging out with the people that you already know, and you already know what they're going to say, and you already know what solutions they're going to bring to solve the problem. If that was working, we'd have solved the problem already. Why don't we start colliding with more random and unusual suspects so we could learn something new, a different approach, something you've tried in your business that might be helpful to me, somebody who has a completely different discipline or perspective that opens up my lens and gets me to see the problem in a different way.
Right.
These are the things that make us innovators. Those of us that are wired this way, we're constantly looking for that something new, that new idea, something we can try, right? And we need to get better at trying more stuff. Like, sometimes innovation's not any more complicated than that. And we've made it so complicated and hard, and you have to go to 18 committees to get decisions, and, you know, to get a nickel of capital to advance an idea. You know, it takes you 3 years. And, you know,
speaking about capital,
yeah,
you recently, about a year ago, picked up a major funding from the Gates Foundation.
Yeah.
And talk a little bit about that, because that's you know, the proof's in the pudding with the level of clients you're getting now.
No, we've been very fortunate. You know, we've been funded by most of the major foundations, and we have many corporate and large organization clients that are, hey, please help me imagine, prototype, and test an entire different way to do this. Mm-hmm. Because we seem to be stuck in the way it's always worked,
right,
and
right.
we need to break out of that. Our most recent Gates grant, we've had several over the years, is in the education space, and we're trying to help teachers around the country mm-hmm. imagine how they could innovate in their classrooms, their schools, and in their school systems around the issues of diversity and being more inclusive. Right. What do we do? What are the practices? What are the things we can do that are significantly different than what we're doing today that might change the outcome, that might be more welcoming to more diverse student populations
right.
and school populations, that might improve the outcomes of folks working together in a more collaborative way?
So when you go, do you take on an issue like schools? And,
yeah.
you know, we could spend hours talking
right.
about Providence schools as an example
sure.
and their challenges. Is the biggest challenge to getting buy-in and engagement, is it fear? Is it the fear of losing seniority, losing sort of the step structure? Is it, how do you take on those institutional
right.
limitations
so people,
in an environment like
and,
that?
And mostly it's human issues. It's
yeah.
almost never some, you know, we don't have access to technology.
Right.
Some people will say it's we don't have enough money.
Right.
And not that you don't need resources, but often that's the excuse.
Right.
What's really going on here is people are accustomed to working a certain way. This is how a school works. This is the role the teacher plays. This is the role, you know, that the principal plays. And maybe there's a different way to do this, but we don't know how to change, and change is too scary for us.
Right.
So the process has to start with, how do we help you create the safe space so that it's not so scary to experiment? Don't stop doing what you're doing today, but can we actually model a different way of doing this and can create the safe space to do those explorations? And so a lot of what we're doing is helping create the safe space to be able to imagine, what if classroom worked a different way? And then when we get the 8,000 reasons classrooms can't work a different way,
right.
we say, I understand that's how they work today. Keep doing that. Keep making that better.
Right.
Over here, can we say, what if it actually worked a different way, and can we actually prototype and test that?
So right? So why is there so little, I'll just give an example. I've been in Providence City Hall twice for
right.
ministerial things,
right.
you know, small little paperwork
right.
things. And I have to say, I think it functioned in 2017 like it did probably
right.
in 1917.
Right.
It was paper-based, it was...
Right.
I won't say it was the highest service-oriented experience I've had. Stand in a line, wait, somebody did something, all on paper. How do you break, how do you reinvent that in an environment
well,
like?
Well, a couple of things there. First of all, people used to say to me when I worked in state government here in Rhode Island, knowing my private sector background
right.
and knowing how anxious I get about standing still,
right?
Because right, I've always been about what's next. People would say to me, how could you work in government? Didn't it move too slow for you? Wasn't it too bureaucratic? And I had just come off of 25 years of working for large corporations,
right?
right? And I thought about it. I said, you know what? Government moves slow, no argument there. But I just work with big corporations around the world. And they don't move so fast
yeah,
either.
Right,
these
right.
are big bureaucracies
right.
that aren't very good at transforming their business model either. And then I tease my friends in higher ed, the folks who run colleges
oh,
and
forget.
Universities. They're worse than government and big business. Here's my point. All large institutions were designed for a different era.
Mm-hmm.
They came about during the industrial era. They learned how to scale. Right? They learned how to compete for share with other similar organizations. I don't care if you're a hospital, a school, a government agency, or a company. This is the way my industry works.
Right.
Right. And all of a sudden, all of these young whippersnappers from Silicon Valley are coming out and disrupting entire industries.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Because they're using technology in a more disruptive way. And I go back to the institution leaders and say, why couldn't we do that? Why could they do that? They had the freedom to build a different model. Right. And you were stuck in the existing model.
Right.
Why can't you create a sandbox with the conditions to explore and test different models while you're still running.
Could you do that in government in Rhode Island?
Yes, I think you can do that. I think you can do that by creating those safe spaces. So if you want to create a better way to serve citizens, first of all, let's understand the citizen experience. And most government agencies were designed so many years ago, they've forgotten who the customer is and what their current experience is. They're so far removed from that. Right, like any organization that got removed from their customers, all of a sudden customers get frustrated, citizens get frustrated with what government's providing for them, and just tweaking the current model isn't going to work. So how do we create whole new service models, right? So how do we, instead of, you know, building the huge new healthcare system so that still supports the old model,
so
what are the different models that we could be creating, you know, and could we be experimenting with them to better serve the needs of Rhode Island citizens?
So Rhode Island's got three big technology initiatives right now, all in some level of distress. You have the DMV and HealthSource. And best as we've reported on and experienced, none of them are very good experiences. All of them are cumulatively in the hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars between the three of them. Without blaming anyone, those folks are getting blamed, and there's plenty of lawsuits, and there'll be enough depositions to choke a horse. What's the way we could do better in the initiative of a project like that? So take DMV. We're going to start anew.
Beautiful.
My first suggestion would be just turn it over to the state of Massachusetts, because when you go on their website, you can do about 50 things online, and you don't ever have to touch a brick-and-mortar location. But absent that, how do you... How do you recreate a DMV in Rhode Island?
So I still think you have to continue to try to make the service better, given the infrastructure, given the people that you have.
Sure.
That's innovation, you know, to create incremental improvements.
Right.
But if you've reached the conclusion that that system, that model, is not going to meet the needs of Rhode Islanders, so the way you do that is you put that system over here. And instead of worrying about how I'm going to change it, you start with citizens and what their experiences are. You figure out what job they're trying to do. You figure out how you can put new capabilities together to do it. And you do this at a small scale, just to demonstrate that there's a different model.
So is that one of the biggest problems of all these systems, as the reports come back, is that in each case, we sort of jumped in the deep end of the pool without necessarily having the technology.
We're too rooted in what the legacy system is,
and
we're not open enough to say maybe there's a different way to get this done. Maybe we can use technology in a different way. The old school way of doing very large systems building projects, I mean, I know I was a partner at Accenture. Yeah, we did this work all over the world.
Right.
Has now started to shift to more flexible capability, many of which are sitting up in a cloud, you know, that I don't need the local, you know, system support that I used to need. You're not going to convince me, take DMV. If you look across the country, you know, I don't know how many DMV systems, you know, are there 50, you know, plus some big municipalities?
Right, probably some counties.
And you're never going to convince me that the way Rhode Island needs to do DMV is so different than the way they do DMV in all the rest of the states. Why hasn't someone created a platform, right, and gone into the business of, in the cloud, providing the necessary capabilities so that each individual location can better serve their citizens?
So, but is some of that we just don't have enough folks who are experienced in recreating things? You know, if the top 10 people at the DMV probably have never recreated anything other than their own. They've always worked in the Rhode Island DMV. So how do you expect them to be the architects of innovation?
Well, they need some help, and that's the kind of work that we and lots of other organizations do. They need to understand that before they figure out how to change all of DMV, they need to model what that change could look like, so they don't get into these traps of, we did it on paper, we did it, you know, in the conference room, and then all of a sudden we started building it, and to find out that it was a lousy customer experience, and the implementation process, you know, is a disaster.
Right. I mean, our biggest DMV, just to stay on this subject, our biggest DMV reinvention success is to allow AAA to do it.
Yeah, what's wrong with it? And if you're in charge of the government, and you're trying to serve citizens, like, so what's wrong with the fact that AAA, I go to AAA, you know, and when I can,
right.
And it's a much better experience.
Much better.
So now what's the vested interest that says we got to keep doing it the old way?
Right.
Right. And is it because we're trying to protect the jobs of the folks and we're trying to not get better and we're trying to not deliver the kind of customer service that we know citizens, you know, are looking for?
Right.
So we got to get from everything has to be take the way it works today, and we have to just do the stuff that's easy and that people don't resist,
right?
And we have to say no, we got to be bolder than that, but we're not going to go right to the bold solution. We got to model it. I think you model it in the real world. You shine a big storytelling spotlight on it, so we give you access to it,
right.
So here on Go Local Live you're talking about what we're trying to do together as a state around DMV,
right?
And everybody starts to own it more, there's more engagement in it, and the next thing you know, we're creating the solutions that every other state in the country is looking for.
Right.
We should be the innovator, right? Not the last state to put a reasonable DMV, you know, kind of capability in place. To be the innovator takes a different approach, takes a different process, and frankly, the willingness to try more stuff, right? And that's what we don't do. We don't try anything because we're afraid we're going to fail,
right.
Or someone's going to point to us and say, you failed,
right.
Right? Well, I would much rather fail at a smaller scale and then keep iterating until I got it right. For DMV, for education, like you pick any
right.
capability set and system that you want. And at least then we're going to have more confidence that this thing could scale, that it could work.
Right.
And people are going to see it more. So it's not you're not unveiling it at the end and saying, here we are, we just turned on the switch to go live.
Right.
Let people be part of the design and implementation program of it. And then all of a sudden, we're going to be more supportive of the bumps in the road than the way it is now. Too much top-down push. And not enough organic, you know, bottom up.
Right, right, right. In Rhode Island, what are we good at innovating?
Yeah.
Give some examples of where, you know, the smallness of Rhode Island and the connect. I mean, listen, we launched last Wednesday. In the first week, we'll have had, you know, the governor's coming on Wednesday, the Speaker of the House is coming on Thursday, you're
right.
on, Gary Sass is on.
That's fantastic.
Entrepreneurs at all levels, restaurateurs. Right. So we're trying to create a place in which people can share ideas
right.
and talk about ideas and challenge things and announce things. But where else are we in Rhode Island really good at innovating?
We have all of what I call the raw material.
Mm-hmm.
And we have the small world properties that you just mentioned. Right, it's because we have 11 colleges and universities
Absolutely.
With a ton of know-how.
Right.
We have an incredible creative class, right, with designers that know how to design physical products all the way through experiences in new communities. Right, so we have all the raw material. What we don't have are the optimum conditions
mm-hmm.
for those capabilities and those people to work together on modeling what's next. And we don't have the willingness to try more stuff and push for it. So what do I mean by that? So you know what happens when Uber, you know, tries to come in, you
right.
know, to provide a nice new service to Rhode Islanders, right? What the incumbent taxi cab industry claims foul,
right.
you know, and says, that's not
well,
fair.
Well, Portland, but, Oregon, right? Taxis blocked it for, God, a year longer than they ran the clock here, so, you know.
Well, I was just in Austin this past week,
right.
Making a visit to the University of Texas system, and they don't have Uber there either,
right?
Which is kind of ironic,
right.
how we
right.
think about Austin. But the point is that we need to be at the early end of innovating, which is going to cause some disruption to some of the incumbents.
Mm-hmm.
But we need more incumbents that are saying, if we don't innovate, we don't get better.
Right.
Right. So we all as a state need to get better so that we'll be more competitive.
So let me ask you, you know, Gary was just on talking about subsidies. We've been good lately at GE, Johnson & Johnson, big companies. I have to say, I'm not sure our $20 million or $10 million makes a big difference to them. And sometimes I wonder about if that's a great idea to give massive. But we don't have a lot of programs for small innovation.
Right.
You know, if Slater, which is kind of a little bit bigger than a pure startup.
Yeah.
And we don't have any funding sources in any kind. Not that you need money isn't the way to innovate at all times. I'll tell you, in all honesty, the genesis of Go Local started about 2009, and we launched in 2010, there was no money on the street for anything.
Right.
And if we'd had money and raised significant capital, we would have been gone in a year. Because we would have spent money the way the known always spent money.
Right.
We had to figure something out every single time.
Yeah.
Because de facto, we have no capital.
Well, that's a great point. I mean, constraints are one of the important ingredients to innovation.
Right.
Right. Like, so narrowing down, what job are you trying to do? Whose problem are you trying to solve?
Right.
If you're constrained in resources, you're going to start experimenting. This is what entrepreneurs do.
Right.
Like, how do I solve that customer's problem? Right. And then I worry about how to do it for 100 people or a million people.
Right.
But it starts with one, like looking someone in the eye and saying, what problem are you trying to solve? How do I help you solve that? So I totally agree with you. But the key here around the programs are, I think the state's doing a nice job now. They actually have resources.
Yep.
A lot more than I had, you know, when I had those economic development.
Well, you had that
tools.
Nice tin cup, yeah, that you were shaking out.
Yeah,
in front
no,
of,
no kidding.
EDC at
and
the time.
I do think you need catalytic funds. I like when the government puts catalytic funding in that then gets leveraged and sent up. My concern around some of the incentives they have now is that you're going to run out of that bucket of money.
Yeah.
Right? So let's make sure that the pieces you're putting in now are going to sustain themselves with more economic activity where we don't have to keep giving incentives out.
Right.
But I don't mind the use of smart incentives. I think it's important to keep a check on that,
mm-hmm.
to make sure that the money that we are spending is in fact incenting what we want.
But is there that
is working.
But is there that money for that kid at whether he's yeah. down at URI in Kingston or he goes to the Met School
yeah.
or he's up at Brown and he's got an idea.
Yep.
And you know it's you know we there's some level of capital
yep.
needed to be able to spawn this idea
right.
to get it out, to test it, to get it a little bit of marketing to see if it functions. And right now, I don't think there's any tools per se.
More than when I was there, but, you know, maybe they would say not enough. And they're trying to work with tools that can work for larger, you know, companies and
right.
can work for smaller innovators. You know, they have some programs there, you know, that are working towards that. I think we're decent at and getting better at invention and working with the colleges and universities.
Yeah.
There's a lot more work we need to do there to tighten that network. To bring more research dollars into the state.
Mm-hmm.
We're doing okay on the small population of entrepreneurs and startup folks,
mm-hmm.
right? Whether it's social entrepreneurs and ventures or whether it's tech-based entrepreneurs.
Yep.
We need to shine a big spotlight on them. We need to support them. We need to make them more central
mm-hmm.
to what we're doing in economic development. And then this third piece, which is, you know, perhaps the most important, because you can't get there solely off of IP that flows out of the university or a startup entrepreneur.
Right.
I believe you have to help the existing set of companies here to be more innovative,
right.
to be more competitive, to be stronger in negotiations around mergers and acquisitions, as opposed to always being the one, you know, on the weaker end of that.
Right.
We need, if you have a more innovative base of employers and institutions here, you're going to
you're
be
gonna
a stronger state.
Yeah.
You're going to create higher wage
and
jobs.
And you're going to see spinoffs.
Right. And when you don't innovate and when we don't create a climate where folks can innovate here, you start losing positioning and then you're worried about the phone ringing and saying company X, Y, or Z is moving
right.
out of the state. So you need to be proactive around that and you need to have policies and programs for each of those three buckets. BIF was formed to try to get at that third bucket. How do we help existing institutions? How do we help the healthcare players here
mm-hmm.
innovate so that we're leading the country in the way personalized medicine is going to work, right?
Right.
Not just the technology piece, right, but the actual practice and how we deliver the service to the end user or the customer. Our size really comes into play
yeah,
there,
absolutely.
And it's a huge advantage. I believe we started a conversation about innovation, goes all the way back to Sam Slater, and I think we need to bring that back central
mm-hmm.
to who we are as a state, and we need to celebrate trying more stuff. We have to create the conditions. If you're a big company here and you have a new way of solving a customer problem,
right.
why shouldn't you demonstrate that here so that all the jobs around delivering that nationally actually happen here?
Right.
But if we block that,
right.
if the incumbents try to block that, right? Whether it's the taxi cab industry trying to block Uber, or whether how long it took us to put Minute Clinics, you know, out there. Yeah. Off the argument we're protecting Rhode Island consumers, when in truth what we were really protecting was the incumbent, you know, healthcare delivery system.
Right.
So I just think we have to be honest with ourselves and willing to challenge each other on, do you really want to innovate here in Rhode Island? Do you really want Rhode Island to be a place we can innovate? Then let's reinforce the behaviors around that, so that all of us are out there traveling around the country telling our friends, you got to come to Rhode Island because you can innovate there.
Right.
And you can't just say the word, so it's not just a marketing campaign. You have to be able to deliver it.
That would save the governor some money, because we haven't quite gotten that tourism branding thing down. So well, innovate here might be a good tagline.
But same thing there, too. It's not just the tagline.
No, it's not.
It's the actual delivery of the promise.
It's got to be
authentic. When you experience the state, you're actually living that experience, so you're going back and telling all of your friends. That's how you build new customers from the bottom up. It's the same for a state as it is for a company, as it is for a hospital or a college.
This has been fantastic.
Great to
greatly appreciate you coming in.
Oh, my pleasure.
And look forward to you coming in hopefully next week. And this is, you know, this discussion needs to take place. It needs to take place all over the state. I was thinking the other day, we need a good Shark Tank type of environment, too, where people can bring their ideas.
And a better way to exchange ideas, and more important than just to talk about it.
Yeah.
Because we're pretty good at convening and getting people to come together around here. It's the actual purpose. It's the actual leaving that meeting and actually rolling up your sleeves and experimenting with different ways to solve our problems.
I don't have time to go to those meetings. Thanks so much. I really appreciate it.
Josh, thanks for having me. Look forward
and,
to it.
And thanks so much for everybody for tuning in on Business Monday. Thank Deepwater Wind for helping support this initiative. And look forward to seeing everybody tomorrow at 3 o'clock with Molly and Kate signing off. Thanks so much.